Hello friends, welcome to video series on geography. In this video, I'll be explaining about air masses, fronts and temperate cyclones. In my previous video, I've explained about jet streams. Jet streams play a very important role in determining the path of temperate cyclones. So please watch my video on jet streams before watching this video. First, I'll begin with air masses. There are two kinds of air masses. One is cold air mass and the other one is warm air mass. So as the name itself suggests, the cold air masses are formed over the polar regions and the warm air masses are produced over the tropical regions. And the region above which these air masses form are called as source regions. Source regions supply the air masses with heat, that is the temperature and other physical properties directly depend on the temperatures of source region. So they establish a heat and moisture equilibrium with the source regions. So source region determines the temperature as well as humidity. For example, so the air masses which are formed on continents have lesser amount of moisture, whereas those air masses which are forming above oceans have greater amount of moisture. So the source region determines the humidity factor as well. And ideal source region is a region which has gentle divergent air circulation. So divergence is associated with high pressure region at the surface of Earth. So in my previous video, while discussing about pressure belts and permanent winds, I've explained in detail about subtropical high pressure belt and polar high pressure belts. So these regions where there is divergence of air usually aid the formation of air masses. Again, air masses are not just a small parcel of air. They're very huge parcel of air where they extend from bottom layers of troposphere to the top layers of troposphere. We know that Earth is spherical in shape and it has atmosphere, a thick blanket of atmosphere, and the lower layers of atmosphere is called as troposphere. So this lower layer or the immediate layer is troposphere, and we know that troposphere has a thickness of 16 to 15 kilometers at the equator, whereas at the poles it is only about 7 to 8 kilometers. And hence the air masses have vertical extent of up to 7 to 8 kilometers in the polar regions, whereas the vertical extent ranges from 15 to 17 kilometers in the tropical regions. So air masses, their thicknesses depends on whether they are formed over the tropics or whether the polar regions. So in this figure, we can see the different kinds of air masses, the ones that are formed near the equator. So these air masses which are formed near the equator are equatorial air masses. They are less stable compared to the ones that are formed in the subtropical high pressure belt. This is roughly the subtropical high pressure belt, 25 to 35 degrees Celsius. So the air masses which are formed in this region are comparatively very stable, whereas the air masses what we see here as these three air masses, one in Pacific and Indian Ocean, and then we have one in Atlantic and the other one in Pacific, the continuation of other air mass. So these air masses are comparatively not so stable air masses. That is, they get dissipated very quickly because of unstable weather conditions, whereas the air masses in the tropical regions, that is subtropical high pressure belt regions, are significantly stable. And other than that, we have air masses that are occurring in the polar regions. Even these air masses are very stable. So if you look at this figure, we can see that there is no significant air mass formation in the temperate regions. Usually this is roughly the temperate regions. So in this region, we don't see the formation of air masses because the temperature here is moderate. So air masses form only on the regions where the temperature reaches extremities. For example, in the tropics, we have very hot climate. Here the temperature is maximum, whereas in the polar regions, the temperature is minimum. And these are the only two regions which facilitate the formation of air masses. And even if there is formation of air masses in temperate regions, they only last for few hours or few days, not more than few days. Whereas the tropical and polar air masses last for few weeks or even months. And again, the polar air masses are very strong in winters, whereas the tropical air masses are very strong in summers. And the region where these air masses meet is the zone of unstable condition. So the air masses individually have no significant effect on the climate of the region. For example, tropical air masses doesn't influence much the climate of tropics, and the polar air masses doesn't influence in a significant way the climate of polar regions. Whereas when these air masses meet, that is their intersection zone is in the tropics. So this region sees significant changes in weather because of the interaction between these two air masses. So this interaction creates something called as fronts, about which I'll be explaining after air masses. Coming to properties of air masses, they depend on their physical properties depend on source region. the temperature and humidity factor as well as density depends on source region, where the temperature supplied influences the thickness as well as other properties. And based on origin, we have two types, tropical and polar, and they are scattered from surface to lower levels of stratosphere, which is almost in contact with the upper layers of troposphere, and they're spread across thousands of kilometers, as we have seen in the previous world map figure. They're spread across thousands of kilometers, sometimes covering few countries. And air masses sustain their physical properties if at greater heights, so they are less stable at the ground level, whereas they are most consistent in the upper levels of troposphere. And stable air masses are the ones in which convection is negligible. So air masses doesn't last long if there is convection, and convection is nothing but the upliftment of warmer air followed by the subsidence of colder air. So this cycle repeats. This is called as convection. So if there is convection, there is huge amount of disturbance, and the air masses don't form on regions where there is a significant disturbance. So they need gentle divergent air, that is subsidence of air, the exact opposite of convection. I mean, the exact opposite of formation of equatorial low pressure belt. Here we see the formation of high pressure zones at the bottom, and this kind of divergent air helps in the formation of air masses. And when two air masses meet, the heat transfer takes place slowly. This is because of significant differences in physical properties like humidity factor as well as temperatures. So these changes in physical properties doesn't allow ready mixing of air masses, so they take a large amount of time for them to get mixed. So in this figure we see different source regions. We have the Arctic regions, which is a significant source region for the polar air masses, and then we have the Siberian region, which is part of Arctic region, and then northern Canada, where we see the formation of continental polar air mass, and then we have Greenland. Other than that, we have regions like Sahara and tropical oceans, which gives rise to the formation of tropical air masses. So continental air masses, usually they occur or form above the continents, as a result they don't have significant amount of moisture, so they are usually associated with comparatively stable conditions. Coming to maritime polar air masses, they have temperatures comparatively lower. They form in latitudes which are south of the continental polar air masses. So we can see this is maritime polar air mass, which is forming in the Atlantic Ocean. So continental polar air masses moved over the warmer oceans give rise to maritime polar air masses. So as the temperature of this region is significantly very low, it doesn't aid the formation of air masses. These air masses which we see in the temperate regions are the ones which are migrated from the continental regions. So if this air mass has migrated to the oceanic regions, then it would form maritime polar air mass. And they will accumulate significant amount of moisture due to their presence in the oceans. But again, this is also associated with comparatively stable conditions. At max, we see the formation of fog and drizzle, what we see weather in the regions of Great Banks. Other than that, there is no significant changes in weather because of maritime polar air mass. And then we have continental tropical air mass. The best example is Sahara air mass. This huge air mass which forms over these Saharan countries is a continental tropical air mass, which is very warm. It takes the temperature of this region to about 40 to 50 degrees Celsius, and when these air masses move towards the neighboring regions, then they can significantly raise the temperature of surrounding regions. Again, these air masses have no significant moisture in them, and hence they don't produce significant amount of rainfall. So maritime tropical air masses are the very important ones because they carry moisture from the oceans towards continents. So in summers they are associated with comparatively unstable conditions, whereas in winters the conditions are comparatively stable. So the most important part is the influence of air masses on world weather. As I've already explained, there is this region, the temperate region, which acts as zone of convergence between the tropical and polar air masses. So this zone is the region where there is significant weather changes because of interaction of air masses, and this is how air masses affect climate of the temperate regions. Other than this, their influence on these regions is comparatively lower, that is polar and tropical regions. All that they can influence is bring in very cold weather in the polar regions and very warm weather in the surrounding regions of the tropical regions. And they help in transport of heat and moisture between oceans and continents. And that is, they help in transfer of latent heat. So I previously explained what is latent heat. I'm not going to tell that in detail. So they help in latitudinal heat balance, and they play a significant role in formation of tropical cyclones. I've told in temperate regions they have greater influence. We studied this in detail while in the topic of tropical temperate cyclones. So their vertical distribution influences the temperature. So its stability and instability depends on whether they are forming on oceans and continents, and also their temperature differences. And air masses carry atmospheric moisture from oceans to continents. So this is why the interior regions, which are very highly interior in Northern America, receive significant rainfall. For example, the region between the borders of Canada and America are continental regions. That is, they are deep within the interiors, but still these regions see significant rainfall because of the polar air masses which move towards these regions. For example, the air mass that is forming in Gulf of Mexico moves towards this region, whereas the polar air masses fall from polar regions. So the interaction between these two air masses produce significant amount of rainfall within the interiors of continents. Whereas if you see the Siberian Plateau, etc., here the air masses are separated by great distances, and hence the interaction between air masses is significantly low, and hence we have a kind of climate called a steppe climate in this region because of lack of moisture. And other than that, we have Arctic region as well. That is the northern part of Russia, Siberian region, etc. Even there is no significant rainfall. There is only precipitation in the form of snow. And this precipitation is also very slight because of lesser moisture, as there is no interaction between huge air masses of tropical and polar regions. So this is all about air masses. Next, we'll see about fronts, but before studying about fronts, we need to look at different types of clouds. So from now on, we'll see different names of clouds like cirrus clouds, cirrostratus clouds, cumulonimbus clouds, altostratus clouds, nimbostratus clouds, etc. So these names keeps on occurring. So this picture here helps you as a guide for your future study of various atmospheric phenomena. And as we see these names, we can quickly come back to this picture and look where the cloud formation occurs. So based on altitude, there are different three types of clouds. One is low clouds, middle clouds, and high clouds. We can see these are low clouds. Low clouds include cumulonimbus clouds. Usually cumulonimbus is a cloud which extends all over the troposphere. So this is the cloud which gives rise to thunderstorms. And also during cyclones, we have different multiple combinations of these clouds. So these clouds are particularly very important when it comes to influencing the climate of world. Whereas there are other clouds like nimbostratus clouds, which are part of low clouds. So nimbostratus clouds are the clouds which bring precipitation for a very long time. They usually cover a very vast region. They form a thick blanket like outlook on the near the bottom layers of troposphere, and these layers, these kind of clouds are associated with climates where the precipitation lasts for few weeks or few days. So in cumulonimbus cloud formation, we see precipitation occurring for only few hours or few minutes, but whereas in nimbostratus clouds, the precipitation length is much longer. Other than that, we have stratus cumulus clouds, and then we have stratocumulus clouds. All these clouds form in the bottom layers, and in the middle regions we have altocumulus and altostratus clouds. So remember that the middle clouds starts with the name alto. So altostratus and altocumulus clouds are the clouds which are forming in the middle, are the middle clouds. That is, so their distances above surface would be about 4 to 6 kilometers. And above that we have cirrus clouds. Cirrus clouds are high clouds. Usually they occur in the form of ice crystals. So here the region is very cold because of fall in temperature with increase in height. We know that there is something called as lapse rate. As we move upwards, there is fall in temperature. That is, for every 1 kilometer, we have 6.5 degrees Celsius fall in temperature. So this fall in temperature creates very low temperatures in this region. And hence here, most of the clouds occur in the form of ice crystals, especially the cirrus clouds. So we can see cirrus are the part of higher clouds, and cumulus is nothing but they are accumulated in the form of heap of cotton. If we just place few heaps of cotton, the kind of structure we obtain is seen in the form of cumulus clouds. And then we have stratus clouds. Stratus itself resembles their form in layers. So one layer above the other gives rise to stratus clouds. So when stratus clouds are formed in the lower levels, they are called simply stratus, whereas if they are formed in the upper levels, they are called as cirrostratus, and in the middle levels they are called as altostratus. And along with that we have cumulus. So cumulus is simply a heap like structure. A heap of cotton would appear like a cumulus cloud. So cumulus cloud occurs in all three levels, and they are called cirrocumulus in the upper layers, and then altocumulus, and followed by cumulus in the lower layers. So for all this, the most important ones are cumulonimbus because of their rain bearing effect, and then nimbostratus. And there is one particular phenomena called as sun's halo. Sun's halo is an optical phenomena which usually occurs due to refraction of light in the hexagonal ice crystals which are part of cirrus clouds. So this is an hexagon with six faces, regular hexagon, not exactly. But when there is refraction of light through this hexagon, then there is kind of optical phenomena which is observed from Earth's surface. It is called as sun's halo. Usually in polar regions, it appears as in the times of sunset and sunrise, whereas in the tropical regions, it appears over the head. So here is the question from previous papers. Sun's halo is produced by the refraction of light in water vapor in stratus clouds, ice crystals in cirrocumulus clouds, ice crystals in cirrus clouds. So we have both cirrocumulus clouds and cirrus clouds, which are part of upper layers of troposphere. So this is the region where we have cirrus clouds. So in this region, that is about 6 kilometers above the surface, the temperature is not significantly cold. Here the cirrus clouds may be in the form of water droplets or partially in the form of snow or ice crystals, whereas the top layers where we find cirrus clouds from range of 8 to 13-14 kilometers, we see they are cirrus clouds. So these clouds are considerably at greater heights, and hence they are usually present in the form of ice crystals. So sun's halo is produced due to refraction in the hexagonal ice crystals which are present in cirrus clouds. So the answer is C. Now let us move on to fronts. Fronts is a very important topic. So fronts is nothing but interaction between various air masses which creates a transitional zone between the air masses, and this transitional zone is called as front. So the two air masses meet in the temperate regions, so the front formation is exclusive to the temperate regions. So this is the region where we usually observe fronts, and we have seen that the air masses don't merge readily because of significant change in physical properties. And there is also kind of phenomena which is happening between these two air masses when they are meeting, that is when the tropical air masses and the polar air masses meet. They don't simply push against each other. Instead, sometimes what they do is they undergo convergence. Convergence is slightly different because instead of these straight paths, they usually follow a cyclonic kind of path where they converge. We know that in convergence, how a low pressure system is created. So this is because of Coriolis force. So instead of straight paths, we see convergence happening at some sort of deflecting angles. So this convergence is the region again which doesn't facilitate the quick mixing of air masses. So this property is very important because this absence of quick mixing of air masses produces very long lasting rainfall like situation in the temperate regions, especially in winter months. So frontogenesis is the formation of fronts, that is the transitional zone. So in this figure we can see that how the convergence is occurring. And this zone, this line we can see here, this line is the region of fronts. So what we see here is the front formation, and there are three different kinds of fronts, namely four different kinds, namely stationary, cold, warm and occluded fronts. So all these fronts are formed due to convergence, and some are formed due to moving against each other. So we'll study these in detail in this section. So frontogenesis is nothing but the formation of fronts, and they caused by converging air. And they chiefly occur in subpolar low pressure belt, because the subpolar low pressure belt is the belt where the belt formation is due to dynamically induced factors like the blocking effect of the winds due to Coriolis force. So here there is, due to blocking effect, there is upliftment. This upliftment creates low pressure at the bottom layers. This lower pressure is associated with convergence. So convergence, we know how it forms. So this convergence gives rise to converging air movements of air masses. So frontolysis is a phenomenon where the front simply dissipates, that is, the front formation is frontogenesis. Genesis is nothing but origin. So frontolysis is nothing but front dissipation. So to understand front dissipation, we need to understand about occluded front. So we'll see there what is frontolysis. So this is how fronts are formed. The first one is called a stationary front, and this stationary front, when there is convergence between stationary fronts, we have fronts which are called as cold front, and this is warm front. So these kind different kinds of fronts are formed due to converging air masses. So we'll study one by one in detail. First, let us look at stationary front. So what happens in stationary front is two air masses, which one from tropical regions and the other one from polar regions, move against each other. Here the convergence is comparatively less significant and the air masses simply move head on, that is, they move as if they are colliding. And due to greater differences in temperature and moisture content, they don't mix readily. Instead, they just form a boundary region between these air masses. And this boundary region, what we see here, is called as stationary front. So stationary front is associated with the formation of cumulonimbus clouds, and hence there is significant amount of torrential rainfall. So how is this cumulonimbus clouds come into existence? We see in here, the cold air mass is pushing against the warm air mass, whereas the warm air mass is pushing against the cold air mass. But before they are meeting, usually there is certain gap here which is filled with significant amount of air, which is comparatively at different temperatures compared to the warm air mass and cold air mass. And this air obviously has a certain amount of moisture, and when these two air masses are colliding, this central air, that is air between these two regions, is uplifted. So uplifted is associated with fall in temperatures due to lapse rate. And when there is fall in temperatures, we know that there is condensation. Condensation gives rise to cloud formation, and cloud formation gives rise to rainfall. So this is how stationary front influences the climate of temperate regions. So it results in cumulonimbus clouds and subsequent heavy torrential rainfall. So some certain properties of stationary fronts are as follows. So wind motion on both sides of the front is parallel to the front. So instead of wind motion which occurs in the opposite directions, we have where the wind motion would occur parallel to the front. And overrunning of warm air along such a front causes frontal precipitation, as we have seen. Once this boundary resumes its forward motion, it once again becomes a warm front or cold front. So here it depends on whether the cold front is stronger or warm front is stronger. Usually in most of the cases, it is the cold front which is stronger. So if it offers a significant push against the warm air mass, in such a case, the warm air mass will be replaced by the cold air mass. In such a case, this region, which was particularly under the influence of warm air mass, will now be under the influence of cold air mass. Hence, this region here, we see significant change in fall in temperatures. So in a matter of minutes, the temperature might fall by 5-10 degrees Celsius. So this is how the movement of cold and warm air mass influence the temperatures. In very less cases, we see warm air mass which pushes the cold air mass. In such a case, we see this region significantly turning into high temperature region. And cyclones migrating along stationary front can dump heavy amount of rainfall, resulting in significant flooding along the front. So to understand about cyclones, first we need to study occluded front. Once we study occluded front, we'll know why cyclones are greatly influenced by the frontolysis or the formation frontogenesis or the formation of fronts. So in the above figure, we can see the two air masses which are pushing, and this is simple for stationary front. We have the cold front which is pushing against warm front, and warm front which is pushing against cold front. So it is stationary because in this front, usually in this kind of front formation, usually there is no winner. It is like a tie between cold and warm air mass. Next, we'll see about cold air mass. Cold front is also a very important front. Even cold fronts bring significant amount of rainfall. Here, the warm air mass usually exists along a region, and we have cold air mass which is particularly very strong compared to the warm air mass. In this case, when the cold air mass is quickly moving towards the warm air mass gets uplifted, and the upliftment is associated with fall in temperature, which is further creates condensation. Condensation results in cloud formation, and we have rainfall. So usually the cloud formation here is cumulonimbus. So as I've explained, cumulonimbus extends from lower layers of troposphere till the upper layers of troposphere, and cumulonimbus clouds cause significant amount of rainfall. So this is the symbol of cold front, where the cold front is the clear winner and the warm air front is completely uplifted by the cold air front. So in cold air front, what we see is complete fall in temperature of the region. So as this cold air front, cold air mass is moving towards the warm air mass, it simply covers all this region, and hence here, which were particularly at warmer climates, now come under significantly cold temperatures, and hence here the temperature fall is comparatively drastic. That is, the temperature fall might be anywhere from 5 to 15 degrees Celsius in just a matter of few minutes. So coming to the cloud formation, the first clouds which are formed are cirrus clouds. So in the initial stages, when the front is moving, when the warm air mass is sliding above the cold air mass, or which is being uplifted by the cold air mass, in the first stage the cirrus clouds are formed, which are moved towards the upper layers. And after cirrus clouds, we have autostratus clouds and nimbus, and at the end we have cumulonimbus clouds. So nimbostratus clouds bring rainfall which lasts for a very long time, and the rainfall here is between torrential rainfall and drizzling. So drizzling is where drops is very low and the rainfall is completely low, whereas the torrential rainfall is a very quick rainfall where the drop size is comparatively huge. So the nimbostratus rainfall will be between torrential and drizzling. Coming to cumulonimbus clouds, they are formed at the last stages, that is where almost all the warm air mass is being uplifted. In such a case, we see a significant amount of rainfall happening just under the cumulonimbus clouds. So the rainfall formed by cumulonimbus clouds we'll understand when studying about thunderstorms. So thunderstorm is a cumulonimbus cloud. So when I'll explain about different types of precipitation, then I'll explain in detail about cumulonimbus cloud and torrential rainfall. But now this is about cold front. So this is the cloud formation sequence. So if you want more about the influence on weather, what occurs at the different time intervals, that is before the formation of front and after the formation, you can just refer this table where we can see at different stages we have different kinds of climates. So here, for example, is the cloud formation. First we have cirrus, and then followed by altostratus and altocumulus, and then nimbostratus and cumulonimbus clouds. Coming to precipitation in the initial stages, that is where there is formation of cirrus clouds, doesn't bring a significant amount of rainfall, or at least no rainfall at all. Altostratus also has no significant influence on rainfall, whereas nimbostratus and cumulonimbus clouds create huge amount of rainfall. So if you want more, just study this table. Coming to weather, again as I've told, brings good amount of rainfall. And particular importance is the formation of tornadoes in the warm region when there is the push of cold air mass. We can see here the cold air mass is pushing, and we have warm air mass in which there is violent upliftment of air. This violent upliftment of air creates tornadoes, and this is particularly significant in USA. So you remember one thing, that the cold air mass moves very quickly compared to the warm air mass. Usually it is twice faster than the warm air mass. As a result, this quick movement of air mass, as well as because of its steep gradients, we can see it has very steep gradients. So when, if this is the shape, then we say it has comparatively low gradients, whereas if this is the shape, then we have very steep gradients, and hence the air which is getting uplifted gets uplifted very quickly, and hence there is violent upliftment of air which is associated with significant amount of spiraling effect at this surface. So this spiraling effect creates tornadoes. So again, temperature falls significantly. So this is all about cold air mass, cold front. Now let us move on to warm fronts. So in warm front, there is again opposite movement of both cold and warm air masses, but here instead of warm air mass being forcefully uplifted by the cold air mass, like in the cold front, in warm front we see a different case where the warm air mass slides just above the cold air mass. Here again, the warm air mass is moving towards the cold air mass, and the cold air mass is moving towards the warm air mass, or it might be comparatively static. So cold air mass might be comparatively static or moving towards the warm air mass. Here the cold air mass is not as strong as in the previous case, and hence it is not doesn't have steep gradients as we can see. So this is how a less gradient surface looks, and this is how a steep gradient surface looks. So it has comparatively less steep gradients, and here the warm air mass being comparatively weaker, instead of pushing the cold air mass backwards, it simply slides on the surface of cold air mass. So this is the region of front. So this is where we see the formation of warm front. At the ground level, this is where we indicate the formation of warm front is. So here again, we can see the upliftment causes significant amount of rainfall, but one significant change here is we don't have violent upliftment of air. As a result, there is no formation of cumulonimbus clouds. So here the rainfall occurs for a very long time. And coming to the cloud formation, just like in the other case, we have cirrus clouds in the beginning, followed by cirrostratus, autostratus, and nimbostratus. One major difference is there is absence of formation of cumulonimbus clouds. So this is a symbol for warm front. So significant property is frontogenesis is low because the warm air mass moves at much lower speeds compared to the cold air mass. So in this case, the cold air mass being comparatively weaker doesn't also travel fast, very fast. So this is a warm air mass, that is warm front and cold front look. Here we can see this is the cold front in the upper figure. We can see how cumulonimbus cloud is being formed. Whereas in the other case, we see nimbostratus cloud where the warm air mass is sliding above the cold air mass.